when you hold me. There's a place I go. Hello. It's a different high. Hello, Ellie. Welcome back. It's nice to have her back. She was on the last now after a bit of an absence. But she's right back in pole position this time. Now 1-1-5. Up there with Calvin Harris, who's been on pretty much every now for, good 15 years. So, how you all doing? We're straight down to business today. We've got an awful lot to get through. Including, with one or two exceptions, we'll come on to them, probably the best first half for absolutely yonks. It's a star-studded affair, certainly in terms of music quality. We've got some real gems to get through. The album is actually released today, the 28th of July, so we're right on top of things this time around. We're going to go through all the songs together. As always, I ask your verdicts. What do you guys think? Are there any songs that you really like or really don't like? And why? This is great. This is a really good opener. Gets off to a pumping start. Now, if you noticed on some of my recent videos, I've mentioned that I've been going to Scotland a bit recently for work. And I commented on a sort of thing I'd noticed with Scottish music. Really, really liking his sort of dance stuff. And it's interesting to see that it's actually now sort of top of the charts. And it's way beyond just Scotland. That's where it comes from. That's where Calvin comes from, if not Ellie. She's from more Herefordshire way, I think. So, kind of south meets north, or southwest meets north of Hadrian's Wall. It's a real meeting of minds. Her voice is brilliant on this. His music's top draw. It's kind of bouncy techno, but you wouldn't really call it techno, and it's not that bouncy, because it's more chilled and poppy. But in terms of the elements, it's basically chilled out bouncy techno, yeah. Got some nice trance arpeggios in there. It's pretty fast, four on the fours, nice pianos. But her vocals are absolutely angelic, and it's got a really, really good melody and a really good positive spirit. Cracking opener, great way of starting the album. And there's even some breaks that just sort of pop in before it ends, and they hint at what you'd get on a longer version of the song. So what a way of starting this then. Now 1-1-5. Calvin Harris, Ellie Goulding, Miracle. Lewis, well, he doesn't make it three number ones in terms of now positions. This time he's just number two, but you know, it's pretty respectable. Let's get this one on. It is Lewis Capaldi and Wishing You the Best. Now, I've got to say that his stuff has kind of grown on me. I think he's had a really good year this year, and I think he's really kind of establishing himself. Yet again, it's from Scotland. It's not as dancey as half the stuff up there. But it's definitely showing a kind of Scottish influence on music. It's very big at the moment, which can only be a good thing, because Scotland rocks. Maybe not the SNP, but that's a whole other story. We won't go there on this video. I always kind of struggle with Lewis's accent a bit. It's weird. It's not Scottish in a, like, Proclaimers style. He's just got a kind of weird way of enunciating his words. And he's not even the biggest shouter on this side. There's someone will come along later who even outdoes him on the shouting department. So I was just wondering, has he ever done an actual up-tempo number? It's yet another ballad from him, piano and voice only, pretty much. And if that's your bag, you will like it. It's just good that, you know, a guy who's, let's be honest, not a stereotypically teeny heartthrob looker in the traditional sense, can be popular just with his voice and the piano and putting his feelings to music. And I love that. You know, I love the fact that that's still able to get to number two on a Now album in this computerised world we live in. Cut from a similar cloth, indeed probably fairly inspired by him, we have next up David Kushner and Daylight. It's one that came to prominence via TikTok, but at heart it's another very old-fashioned song. Could have been a hit at any time through kind of pop history, really. Very much in this mould of singer and piano. I guess it all starts with Elton, really, doesn't it? Who's Glastonbury performance, if you've not seen it, absolutely worth checking out. If you like pop music and you're interested in musical history over the last however many years, you owe it to yourself to absolutely check out Elton's Glastonbury performance. Anyway, that's not this. This is David Kushner. Right, next up, we've got a new one on me, and her name is Loreen. And she's from Sweden, who are certainly no newcomers to the world of pop music. So let's stick this one on. It's Tattoo by Loreen. Now, it's got more of those sort of dance elements that seem to be coming back. It's incredibly, what would you call it? Scandinavian in its kind of sound sculpture, if you like. It makes you think of fjords and pine forests and mountains and stuff. It's very, very big in scope. It's really, really good. She's got a good voice, an interesting voice. And it reminds me a bit of Sia when it really gets going. That kind of big style. I do wonder if maybe this could have followed Calvin and Ellie, as it's got a similar fast, albeit fairly light, dance beat. Here we go. So it's Loreen and Tattoo. Now, no sooner have we stuck this one on, there's another one I want to play, which is always the hallmark of a good album, when we've got to try and get all the songs that we can featured. We'll just play a little more of this. Tattoo from Loreen, followed by Padam Padam. In fact, it's not pronounced that, that's just me, Adam Adam. Padam Padam, or even Padam Padam. Think of someone telling a bad joke. Padam. It's Kylie. Padam Padam. And it's kind of an onomatopoeia for a heartbeat. Now, funny thing about Kylie is that she made her very first appearance on Now 11. And I just went back to my Now 11 video earlier today because I wanted to, I've been feeling very sad about Sinead O'Connor's death. Very emotional because I think she's amazing. So I went back to Now 11, which is where she made her first Now appearance. And you can hear I was raving about her, genuinely sad. So it's quite interesting that both her and Kylie, Sinead O'Connor and Kylie, both made their debuts on Now 11. Certainly their Now debuts. This is Kylie then, Padam Padam. It's kind of Asian in feel almost. It's still kind of electronic pop, but it's got a kind of Asian sort of melody almost. Not so much the instrumentation. It's really, really good. Really good. It's dreamy, it's original, and it's very Kylie. One of her best for ages. So good stuff. Followed up by David Guetta plundering yet another 90s song. This time it's What Is Love by Hadaway. He's renamed it Baby Don't Hurt Me, and he's brought in, oh dear, Anne-Marie and Coi Leray, two people who I've not really been a bundle over before. So it's not really a patch on the Hadaway original, which he probably knew anyway. The thing is, Guetta can write really good melodies. We can work with people who write them. You think of things like Titanium and Crazy What Love Can Do. These were original songs. It had really good, strong melodies. So it's just a shame he's just churning out these easy kind of copies of 90s dance tunes. You know, they're not bad. He does good stuff with them, but it's just so predictable. What's he going to do next? Scatman John? Zig and Zags? Them girls? The Venger bus is coming? Who knows? Leanne, then. Don't Say Love. Time for some two-step. It's got some nice beats and a good jumpy bass line. Pretty decent vocals. So that's a good tune. That's a good tune indeed. Okay, now on the dance tip yet again. We go to a couple of guys who are no strangers to this stuff. Both really, really good. Nathan Dorr and Joel Corry. And throw in a bit of Ella Henderson, who's done stuff with Nathan on the 21 Reasons. And it's another club banger, really. 0800 Heaven. Does anyone actually use phones these days? I was thinking about that. I use my phone for everything apart from phone calls. In fact, you know, I'll text on it, I'll message on it, I'll look at videos on it, I'll listen to songs on it, I'll even record these videos onto it. Yep, the minute it actually rings, someone actually rings my phone, especially if I don't know the number, I'm like, what do I do? So it's kind of strange having a song about 0800, heaven. Do we even still have 0800 numbers? But you kind of get where she's coming from. It's yet another kind of chapter in this resurgence, a sort of trance, bouncy techno, even a bit of Scouse House. They're definitely on the comeback. And Nathan Dorr and Joel Corry are two people who really know how to do decent club music. I prefer Ella's vocals on this. I think her club vocals are actually better than her ballad vocals, which is somewhat overwrought. So I think this is great. Yeah, this is a really good one. Followed up by another really good one, and there's some great songs on this side. Rudimental and Charlotte Plank, and it's beneath me to make any wood-based puns on her name, so I won't. I'll just log that for future reference. Vibe Chemistry. Dancing is healing. Well, amen to that. And Rudimental, it feels like it's been a while since they've been on one of these, but they're back with aplomb. It's even longer since they did some pure D&B stuff like this is. And it's great. It's a fine slab of commercial D&B. It's got some nice subtle but complicated beats and an enticing vocal. Jazzy, Giving Me. Now, I think it was her on that Belters Only thing a few years ago, Make Me Feel Good. That was a great song. That was exceptional. This doesn't quite stack up to that. It's not quite as stark and haunting. But it's still pretty good. It's nice and rounded. Slab of organ house. So, yeah, that's a thumbs up one. Now, Becky Hill, Becky. I missed you on the last one. Where were you? And now album without Becky Hill. Oh, the money back. She makes up for it here with Lewis Thompson, not Lewis Capaldi, or even indeed the Thompson twins. Side effects. Oh, Becky, you are a one. She's absolutely great. You know I love her. It's no secret. And I was kind of worried that maybe she'd gone off the boil a bit. Well, disappeared. She'd never go off the boil. She's back, and boy, what a good tune. It's not just me being, you know, sort of seedy, if you like. She's a very, very attractive young woman. That's not in question. It's absolutely not in question. But it's music, and it's the melodies, and it's the vibe, and it's her personality, and it's her lyrics. Even if I didn't know what she looked like, I'd still say exactly the same stuff. The melodies she wraps her vocals around are great. It's just instantly catchy stuff. It's a really good pumping groove. Just fantastic. Brilliant pop dance. The best pop dance star of the last 5 years in terms of the vocals. So when she collabs with people like Guetta or Joel Corry or someone or Nathan Dorr. Has she done one with Nathan Dorr yet? That'd be good. Nathan Dorr and Becky Hill. That'd be great. Okay, now, talking of good melodies, we've now got 50-50 and Cupid. Now, in fact, this is 50-50 good, 50-50 shit. No, in fact, it's 90% good, 10% shit. And what it's one of those songs, what you do is you get it into Audacity, you find the offending 10 seconds, and you snip it out, and you never hear it ever again. You do your own edit of it. What am I talking about? I'm talking about one of the most ill-considered 10 seconds of rap I've ever heard in my life. The vocal melody is brilliant. It's really, really nice. It kind of reminds me melodically of Prima Donna Girl by Marina and the Diamonds. And if you remember, I said that was one of my favourite melodies of the entire 2010s. That and Rita Ora, anyway. Timeless sound. It's got elements of 70s and 80s stuff. If you play it and chop it off before you get to this horrendous rap. So there's Becky Hill and Lewis Thompson, Side Effects, and here's 50-50 Cupid, which is 90% a really, really good tune. Really good. But it's got my god-awful rap in it. Not for the first time on this side. And my overall overriding theme of this side is these rap bits are by far and away the worst bits of music. Why? I think mainly because they're not proper rappers. It's taken rap so far away from hip-hop and its roots. It's just detached it from that and it's become something else. It's just become a sort of way to ruin songs, and I don't know why people do it. You've got this nice, chilled, kind of fairly classy song. and it's really going swimmingly, you don't need a rap on it. And if you are going to have one, maybe get a proper rapper. But you don't need it. It just kills the mood. And it needs removing, which I've done on my version of it. There's even a key change on this. So it's kind of a flawed classic. The slight errors of judgment spoiling an otherwise great song. Oh well. Jonas Brothers, Waffle House. Now, has anyone ever done a song about an IHOP, which is my favourite? It's more of a pancake house than a Waffle House. Or Dairy Queen. So we've got a kind of almost 80s kind of Hall & Oates style groove, really, from the Jonas Brothers. They've been around a fair old while now. They kind of started off as kind of a boy band, and I guess they're a kind of man band now, so they've still got elements of that sound in them. But their songs have always been kind of musically fairly adept as well. So it's kind of very slick, mainstream, quasi-80s style, as indeed of the next few. One Republic and Runaway. I reckon this is possibly the best tune ever. They've been around for ages. There's that awful rap. Listen to it. It's awful. They've actually been around ages and ages, One Republic. I'm trying to overpower the rap. So it goes now. You didn't need that in there. You really didn't need that in there. So One Republic, possibly the best tune. And I think I'll stick a bit of it on. This is Runaway. Yeah, good one. It's kind of popery of various early to mid 80s new wave kind of stuff, and it works really well. One that follows on pretty well is Niall Horan and Meltdown, which has more of these sort of high octane 80s kind of beats. It's got a lot of oomph. It's got some nice vocoder-y backing vocals, maybe not quite as strong a melody as this one. And another one that almost makes you think we're back on Now One, Tom Grennan, How Does It Feel? And it's another one that's got this 1983 style drum beats. I got no beef with that. I love it. I think it's great. And so it's another fun up-tempo song, lots of gusto and good guitars. Tom Grennan's stuff's always been really good, really, to be honest. So there's pretty much four 80s inspired ones there. Waffle House by Jonas Brothers. This one, Runaway, One Republic. Niall Horan, Meltdown, Tom Grennan, How Does It Feel? Now, after these up-tempo songs, just when things go fairly swimmingly, oh great, it's Maroon 5. Almost as great as having Nickelback back. Woo! Actually, let's not be too sarcastic, it's not that bad. It's maybe a bit plodding after these up-tempo ones, and it's kind of a power ballad. It's much more like a real band sounding than the more egregiously processed Maroon 5 tracks. It's just not very memorable. Lots of singing, not much of a melody. Okay, another one with a shit rap. Again, short and sweet. Get your scissors out, edit it out. You never need to hear it ever again. Sigala and Mae Muller and Katie Baser featuring Teflon Don, not Teflon Don, as they call Mr. Trump. Right, okay, well, I didn't really like Katie Baser on the last one. I generally like Sigala, so have a list there. We've also got two scoops of Mae Muller and half a pint of Teflon Don. Pretty pumping song. Sigala provide the quality I would have thought, and it's got a good chorus, but it's just got that shitty god awful rap on it. Now Becky Hill would never ever do that. I don't think she's ever done that, and I can't see her ever doing it, because it's taste and class, and she's a million times better, and she's had a million more hits and better tunes. She doesn't need to do it. You don't need to do it. It doesn't add anything. So I thought I'd just say that. Right, okay. Let's stick on some BB Rexha now. And Heart Wants What It Wants. Now, the last BB Rexha thing, I think, was the one with David Guetta, Blue Babadie. So she's taken off that sort of stuff, 90s throwbacks. And she follows her own path with this one. It's fairly dreamy, middle ground pop number. Not particularly memorable, but it's nice enough, and the voice is quite interesting. It's certainly a dance sight better than the next one, which is absolute no-brainer, worst song on the side, if not the whole album. It's Ice Spice and Nicki Minaj and Princess Diana. Blimey. Well, Princess Diana died in 97, and I was wondering if maybe Ice Spice might be a throwback to the 90s, maybe a collab between Vanilla Ice and Victoria Beckham or Emma Bunton. Unfortunately, it's not, or maybe fortunately, not that it's any better. It's got some kibberish ebonics, it's got no melody to speak of. It feels about 15 years out of date. It's totally out of place on this side. It just does not fit in whatsoever. So my advice, if they want to emulate Princess Diana, is that Ice and Nikki go for a nice nighttime sightseeing drive through the tunnels of Paris at speed. Now, I wish them no harm, it's only musical, but it's a musical car wreck, it really is. Right, okay, Flo and Missy Elliott, blimey. Well, Nicki Minaj ain't no Missy Elliott, that's for sure. Fly Girl. Flo did that very good cardboard box song. This isn't as good as that, it's not too bad. It's a bit generic, maybe, sort of TLC, Destiny's Child stuff. Lots of warblings. Not bad, not bad. Olivia Dean. It's time for some Little Girl Lost Vocals, part 988776. Music is pretty nice. Probably better than the vocals, actually. It's got some really good 70s grooves. It's got lots of reverb-laden pianos. Can we stick a bit of it on? Olivia Dean. It's got some nice horns in there. And it's Dive. And it's a good song, indeed. Yeah. It's dynamic and it progresses. It's very classy. I don't really like those little girl vocals, but they're not too bad. At least she doesn't break out in some shit rap halfway through. And the music is great. It's really good. It's really nice. So, good one. Olivia Dean. Dive. Okie dokie. We were talking about Now 11 earlier, which saw the debuts of Sinead O'Connor and Kylie Minogue. It also saw the Now debut, although not the chart debut, because she'd been around for years in her band, the Go-Go's. Her solo debut, Belinda Carlisle. Blimey O'Reilly. She's back. And it's a great song. It's Big, Big Love. Now, the thing is, it sounds 80s, but a different kind of 80s to the stuff she used to do. It's more like that 80s stuff some of these earlier songs have gone back to, the more new wave stuff. Maybe it sounds a bit like the Go-Go's. Doesn't really sound more like a kind of power rock stuff that she did in the later half of the 80s. But it's a great song, and her voice is brilliant. It's not short whatsoever. She still sounds fantastic. It's maybe she'll have been up there with Tom Grennan and Noel Horan in the sequence, because it's got that fast 80s synth beat. It's a really good song, really good song. And that's Big, Big Love. Another really good song now. And it really is amazing how Eurovision has got good recently. You know, growing up in the 80s now, you would never get a Eurovision song for Love Nor Money anywhere near it now. Maybe the odd one, like Buck Spears, although that was pre-now. but there was a whole sort of spell in the mid to late 80s and 90s where sort of Eurovision land and Now land were poles apart. I think Jeannie Key was one of the few of the 90s ones that made it onto the Now. So it does happen. But it's been happening more and more recently. Not just the winners, just interesting songs. Alessandra represents, I believe it's Norway, and it gets off to a very dramatic start with kind of what sounds like Gregorian chants. And what a voice! It totally cleanses out the eardrums after that Ice Spice drivel. It's very different. It's massive, it's dramatic, it's got a massive, great techno glam groove, and her immense voice soars. It's actually really, really good, really innovative. So who'd have thunk it? More Eurovision follows from, excuse pronunciation, Kariga, Cha Cha Cha. Another Scandinavian one, this time Finland, and it sure is an action-packed affair. It combines techno and rock and rap and lots of shouting. You know what? I want to play some Alessandro, I think. So this is Queen of Kings from Alessandra. Not Alessandro, Alessandra. So we had Kariga, Kya Kya Kya, more fun Eurovision stuff. And finally on this side, which maybe, again, is not sequenced ideally, maybe could have gone up there with Lewis and David Kushner and stuff, it's Sam Ryder, who, I say, has picked Lewis Capaldi at the post for Pop's Biggest Shouter. Gordon Bennett, he shouts. He really shouts in the most inappropriate manner. That's Sam Ryder. Now, you might think this song has a bit of something familiar. It sounds a bit like Who Wants to Live Forever by Queen, which is unsurprising when you see it. It features Brian May, still going. In fact, Queen, I think they were on the last one, weren't they? Or was it the one before? Brian May, still going strong. It's all right. It's a big ballad. It's just oversung, shouted. So there we go then, all in all, side one, 26 songs, of which only two, I think, have been not good. And only one has been downright abysmal, which was the Princess Diana one. At its best, though, it's been stunning. Some really, really good songs here. The Opener by Calvin and Ellie's fantastic. Lorraine Tattoo's very interesting. Padam Padam by Kylie's interesting. Nathan Dorr, Joel and Ella's good. Rudimental and Plank are good. Jazzy's good, Becky Hill's great, as you'd imagine. All those 80s ones like One Republic, Niall Horan, Tom Grennan, they're really good. Great comeback from Belinda Carlisle. Interesting stuff from Olivia Dean and Flo. BB's was okay. Fantastic song. So let's see what side two is saying. But so far, I'd say one of the best nails for absolutely ages. Right, onwards. Side two, then. Well, we start with... I make it the fourth song called Flowers to Grace and Al in the last few years. Can you work out who the others are by? All different songs as well. A bunch of flowers. We had R.D. We had Lauren Spencer Smith. We had Nathan Dorr. And here we have Miley Cyrus. Now, her voice can sometimes be a bit rough. It's not too bad here. It's actually got quite a nice melody and it's not oversung at all. If anything, it's rather understated. Pretty soulful and quite tuneful. Should we stick it on? So, the big sounds of Alessandra there and Queen of Kings. We go to Miley Cyrus, who kicks off side two with Flowers. Okay, hang on to your hats, everyone. Ed Sheeran's back. You thought we'd seen the last of him, didn't you? It didn't make my last now, despite making four appearances on the one before that. Well, he is back, just once this time. And actually, it's a pretty decent song. Eyes closed. It's not one of his very best. It's not one of his worst. It's pretty solid. Good news is he's got no silly rapping on it. He's learnt his lesson there. Just a nice, decent tune, and it's well sung and produced. Nothing wrong with it at all, really. That's Ed Sheeran, eyes closed. Okay, excuse me while I slip my wrists now. It's Lana Del Rey, Say Yes to Heaven. Another nice and jolly song from her. Have you noticed that as soon as Lana Del Rey made a comeback, Billie Eilish disappeared? You ever seen them both in the same place at the same time? Yes. So, just cheer up for fuck's sake. Life's too short. I mean, it's not bad. It's just... I'm just trying to imagine who would want to listen to it and why. Why would you want to listen to stuff that's so sort of depressing? Maybe just in that kind of mood and it resonates, I don't know. Anyway, that's Lana Del Rey, Say Yes to Heaven. Post Malone, he's a real one. He confuses me. He really confuses me. Because his first song... And my first impression of him, and they do say first impressions last, was awful. It was like a pox on music, especially that song Rockstar. Yeah, if I'm honest, most things he's done have actually been pretty good. And this one's really, really good. Alright, it has some inappropriate F-bombs. Not on the now clean version, but on the video. It's another one that's got this distinctively 80s beat, which is as popular now as it was in 1983. And it's got a reasonably strong melody and some nice instrumentation. Some good shimmering guitars and tinkly pianos. So, you know, credit where credit's due. Post Malone, Chemical. Pink, still here, after all this time, Trustful. Now, her last one was actually really good, Never Gonna Not Dance Again. It was well above average. This one's more pedestrian. It's well sung and produced, and I like the sequencer line and stuff. Some decent drum sounds. It's just the song itself is just very generic and average, and you don't really take anything home with you once you've heard it. Now, a very strange beast indeed from two people who you wouldn't expect would go together. maybe indeed a custard and mustard one. Things that don't go together and maybe can make it work against the odds. Sometimes it's just an unholy racket. I'm talking about Anne-Marie and Shania Twain. Unhealthy. I'm really not sure what to make of it. I'd definitely say of the two singers, Shania is light years above Anne-Marie. I way prefer her voice. You normally expect Anne-Marie to be on some kind of clubby beach, yet here she pitches up in some cowboy saloon in Texas. It's not out and out country, but obviously with the Shania thing, it's got that country vibe. I'm really not sure what to make of it. It's certainly not like anything I've heard Anne-Marie don't do before, so I give her credit for doing something a bit different. Now we come on to another strange beast and another controversial one. A lady by the name of Meghan Trainor. She really is a character, isn't she? Very easy to pick on her as kind of low-hanging fruit. And a lot of people do. But I kind of find that would be too easy. There's something going on with her stuff. It's kind of wrong on every level. Especially when she says, "I am your mother. Stop your mansplaining and listen to me." I'm really not sure of the dynamic in this song. It sounds like a psychologist's wet dream, really. All about mummy issues and stuff. So I'm really, really a bit gobsmacked from that opening line onwards, "I am your mother." It's kind of almost disturbed in a way. Musically, it's sort of halfway between the Andrews sisters and Nicki Minaj. The former, she pulls off rather more adeptly than the latter. At heart, she's some kind of 40s or 50s chick, I think. There's a few token attempts to kind of make it a bit more hip and modern, but that ain't her. That ain't her style, really, and it shows. I do like the production. I like the weird vocal arpeggios. It's a genuinely creative song. It really is. So even if it's wrong on every level, at least it's kind of originally wrong. And for that reason, it's kind of a guilty pleasure. And I kind of give it a free pass. Weird. Maybe I've got mother issues. Now, Mae Muller, "I Wrote a Song." It's the return of the meta song. Songs about songs. I do like songs about songs. It's Mae Muller's second appearance on here. I was really grooving to this one. I thought it had a really pumping groove and melody until that fucking rap again. For the third time on the album, there's even 4 or 8 bars I'm going to have to edit out. I just don't want to hear them. They're audio pollution. Listen, love, you can't rap, but you can sing all right. So just sing and don't rap. It's like having a red wine stain on a white shirt. It stands out like a sore thumb. If you must have a rap break, get a rapper on. But really, if it's not a hip-hop song, you don't need a rap on it, really, to be honest. So anyway, lots of, it says here the lyrics are bum 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 bum. All about that bass. She's got a bit of a bass fixation. If we're talking about psychology, maybe she's got a bit of a, what do they call it, anally retentive or something. That's Meghan Trainor. Okay, now let's go on to Zara Larsson, who we've not heard for a long time. She's making a bit of a comeback here. Now, she used to sound like Rihanna. She used to be a real kind of Rihanna wannabe. And she's not anymore. She sounds a bit more like herself. Yet more preppy 80s beats, yet more nice synths. It's got a kind of weird, jerky groove. And it's actually another really good kind of 80s throwback kind of song. She's Swedish, sounds like it, Zara Larsson. Could almost be Aha or something like that, couldn't it? But I ain't complaining. Now the other thing about this one, you could do a mashup, and indeed I might, like I did with The Weeknd and Shaggy, of this, and I said that Lizzo sounded a bit like them. This takes that same sound, the Pointer Sisters. And you could pretty much sing "I'm So Excited" over this, certainly the chorus. I don't know if it's quite the same chords, but they certainly, they work. So yeah, it's basically very 80s, but it's good. It's really good. I really like it. That's Zara Larsson. Can't tame her. Now Ellie returns, and I do love Ellie. And I love the beats on this one. By the end of the night, I love the sound. The floodgates are definitely open for this kind of synth pop revival. And as a synth pop kid, I love it. I think Ellie's a great pop star and a great singer, but I think the chorus musically is a bit below par and a bit lackluster. I don't want to be too rude, because I just think it's a missed opportunity in terms of the chord pattern. And if you listen to the chorus, you'll hear it's just a bit weak and wussy. It maybe has one good line, but the chords are all wrong. And there's a song coming up which has really good chords, and you hear the difference. I would have changed the chord pattern and built the chorus around a more dramatic chord pattern with some minors in there. This one is just a bit weak, which is a shame, because I don't want to criticise her. The sound is good, but it could do with a really good killer chorus, and it just doesn't have that. Listen to stuff like ABBA, Ellie, if you want to kind of get the vibe of what you could have done there. Or indeed, Aha. Good song from Ollie Murs, yet another mid-80s sounding one. I'm getting as confused as now one, really. It almost sounds like it could come from an Eddie Murphy movie soundtrack. That's Ollie Murs, I Found Her. Now, Sam Smith. I do enjoy reviewing Sam Smith tunes. Linguistically, at least, it's a great exercise in trying to construct a sentence without the use of a pronoun, which might get you into trouble if you get it wrong. So I try and say loads about Sam Smith records without ever referring to Sam by pronoun, if that makes sense. It does save a lot of headaches all round. Now, the last few Sam songs have actually been way above average, bearing in mind that Sam's average has always been really, really good anyway. This one is another piece of subtle dance pop. It's called Lose You, and you just can't knock it on a musical level. Whatever you think of the whole controversy around Sam's persona and stuff, musically, it's great. Now listen to the chord pattern in this. It's got drama, these dramatic minor chords, and they really tug at the heartstrings. It's music to generate feelings, and this is what Ellie should have had on her one. So listen and learn. Good one, Sam. Lose You. And I got through the review without needing a pronoun, so that's always good. Okie dokie, it's my old friend Rita Ora, and let's get this one on. Rita Ora with Guess Who? And he actually makes an appearance in the video. The video, I'm going to have to fast forward a bit because it's got loads of kind of storyline at the beginning. And guess what? Rita Ora is actually really funny, and she's a really charismatic actress, and she's really great. And I'd actually like to see her acting more. I think, gosh, we're... 5 minute video and like the song doesn't start till about 2:30. She's nice, yeah, you know, she's pretty lady, a la Katie Becky Hill. Her songs were always awful until Anywhere, which, as I don't know if I ever mentioned it, is literally one of the best pop songs ever recorded. I don't know how she made something so good. This goes back to being, well, let's say the good bits are the Norman Cook bits, which are already good. She really doesn't add a lot to it. That's quite pumping, musically, but somehow I don't think that was her. Could have been, behind Logic or Ableton. So, kind of a curious egg this. Obviously, it's a Fatboy Slim 1999 classic, Praise You. She's kind of modernised it, although it wasn't really out of date anyway. She's just kind of housed it up a bit. Like I say, the video's got storyline and she's really good in that, but the actual vocals are brilliant and the vocal melody's not great, so strange. She does seem likeable. Now, very odd one now. Adam Lambert and Sigala, You Make Me Feel Mighty Real. Originally a hit in 1978 for Sylvester, and it was a very pioneering kind of space disco thing along the lines of I Feel Love by Donna Summer. Incredibly camp, and it influenced a lot of gay disco of the 80s. But it's beyond just a gay tune, it's a generally popular song. It's therefore no surprise that Adam Lambert is on hand to camp up the whole thing. But yet again, similar to the Ellie thing, they screwed up the chord pattern. You know, chords are really, really important. Really important. Anywhere by Rita Ora, that succeeded because it was built around a brilliant chord pattern. You get the chords right and everything falls into place. And when you're doing a cover and you've already got a chord pattern mapped out, why change it? There's nothing in these chords that's better than the original Sylvester chords. They only kind of detract from the tension of the song. So it's not as spooky, it's not quite as addictive or, you know, just kind of intriguing as the old one. That's not addictive, hallucinogenic is the right word, sort of drug disco-y. It just doesn't have that same edge to it. It's pretty ropey. Now, another mixed bag now. And I'm going to skip right over this. There's no way on earth I'm playing his vocals. Kyle, mate. Kyle Corey, you're normally really good. And your music is really good on this. It can't be denied. But in an awful error of judgment, you've gone with bloody Katie Baser, who is utter crap vocally. One of the worst singers on this album. She ruins it. She absolutely ruins it. Within the first verse, there's more glottal stops than in here on an entire episode of EastEnders. I don't like her voice. It's fucking annoying. Which is a shame, because the music's tip-top. So give me an instrumental version. I can't listen to it with Katie Bass's crap vocals on it. I can listen to this and compare and contrast. These are good club vocals. A totally different style of vocal. They're kind of more mysterious. They're more kind of... they're just not as upfront. They're more kind of reverb-y. And do you know where these vocals come from? There's a good pop question for you. Now, you might be thinking Strike and their 1995 club banger. You sure do. But in fact, they got them from somewhere else. And that's the real pop expert, elite level, to know that. They come from Donna Allen's 1987 song, Serious. Never made it now, but it was on the Hits album 6, I believe, which was a rival compilation in 1987. About the time of Terence Trent D'Arby and stuff. Blimey, what happened to him? Anyway, this is probably a contender for song of the album, really. I love it. It's Borai and Denim Audio, which sounds like a hi-fi shop somewhere outside Uxbridge. Just don't mention you, Liz. Not very popular in Denim, I gather. Anyway, musically, it's absolute cracker of a tune. I do like the ravey ones, don't I? I'm showing my inner raver here, I think. But they're just always great songs. This is a really good one. It's kind of, again, it's hallucinogenic. It's got these nice stabs. It's got some good breaks, kind of old school flavour to it. It's a really, really good song. And it transplants the vocals in really nicely. So, yeah, this is proper good club rave music. Borai and Denim Audio. Now, Jess Glynn, what on earth happened to you? I thought you fell off the face of the side of a planet. Even though, of course, the planet, well, it's flat, isn't it? So you could fall off the faint side of it. Silly me. It's almost like Becky Hill stole her thunder, musically. Jess used to do all these sort of uplifting club pop things, and then Becky Hill came along and Jess seemed to disappear. Now, this has a different sound from her old stuff, or the stuff I made to nows. Should we stick it on? It's a bit more kind of down-tempo. Although, that said, it's still uplifting. You can be down-tempo and uplifting, if that makes sense. It's the rhythm that's a bit more down-tempo. It's not house or anything. It's nice to have her back, yeah? Got some really good choirs on this. Really nice choirs. And they kind of build up over the course of the tune. So that's Jess Glynn, Silly Me. Now Cat Burns is back. Live More and Love More. Now the video is a Beatles-style rooftop performance. Did you ever see Get Back? Oh man, if you know, if you're interested in music in any way, shape or form, you've got to watch Get Back. And then you've got to buy every single Beatles album ever. But I digress, Cat Burns. Now, People Pleaser was a great song. Surprisingly good, and unsurprisingly, she's kind of gone a bit meh again after that. It's not too bad, but it's not too great. A bit forgettable, really. I kind of like her, but it's just not a brilliant song. Shandy Crop, Part of Me follows. Another balladeer in the Lewis mould. He normally oversings and shouts a bit, but this one's a bit trippy. It's not quite as oversung as normal. It doesn't really stand out from the glut, but it's not offensive or too overblown. That's okay. Very good one now. Nothing But Thieves. I'll get this one on. Welcome to the DCC. What's that? Dorset Cricket Club? No, it is the Dead Club City. This is a weird one. This is one of the standout songs on the album. It's almost like Thriller as done by The Weeknd or even Daft Punk. There was a song by The Weeknd that sounded like Thriller. Was it Sacrifice? So this kind of follows on a bit from that. And as you know, I love The Weeknd, who's sadly not on this album. Everyone loves Daft Punk. So this kind of, if you like that, then you'll like this, I reckon. It's got a nice crunchy groove, very original and striking, and it's got some really good synths and intriguing lyrics. I'm a fan. big fan of it. Hosier, and certainly striking song name now, Eat Your Young. Good grief. Eat Your Young, eh? Blimey, I don't know what to make of it. But it's actually a great song. It's really nice. It's got kind of bleary tip-hop grooves. And his voice, again, they're not oversung. They're dreamy. They're shrouded in reverb. They've got a real ambience. There's even some kind of surf guitars in there. It's really inventive and melodic. It's an absolutely great song. Probably Hosier's best yet. And most Hosier stuff's been really good. Now, yeah, for 1975, did you see Noel Gallagher's comments recently? He was really disparaging. He goes, I don't know what they are, but that ain't rock. And he's right. This song, Oh Caroline, is not rock. It's not rock in any way, shape or form. It's pretty much boy band. It's way overproduced. It's soft and abnormal. It's not unpleasant, but it's totally devoid of any kind of punk grit or alternative edge to it. It's uber conformist and mainstream in a way. It's the antithesis to punk and rock and roll. Now, talking of rock and roll then, the Pretenders. Get a bit of this one lined up. Because it's their comeback after years and years and years. I'm not talking about the band, years and years. Here again, don't make this one. So there we go. Nothing but thieves. Welcome to the DCC. Pretenders, let the sun come in. Now, do you know when Chrissy Hynde made her first appearance on one of these? Well, the Pretenders first came in on Now 9 with Him to Her, but Chrissy, in fact, preceded that with her duet with UB40, I Got You, Babe, way back on Now 6. So she's been a stalwart. Doesn't appear very often, but every now and then comes back. Wasn't she involved in that Love Can Build a Bridge charity agglomeration thing? So she's there, yeah, she's made the odd appearance. This is a nice song. It's very rocky, real rock and roll. Compare and contrast to the 1975. Even though she could be their grandma, she's got more punk spirit in her little finger than the whole band put together. It's just back to basics, raw rock, but it still sounds kind of fresh and modern, even though it also sounds like it could have been made in 1978. Just timeless post-punk, really. And we end it with a sad loss indeed, and someone who was on the very first Now One, and a rousing way of ending this. I mentioned it when it appeared on Now 16. I referred you to the David Brent sketch in The Office, which I'm sure you're all aware of. R.I.P. Tina Turner, absolute legend of music. You can hear what I thought of her songs as we went through the Nows. I think most of them I thought were pretty damn good. Some I like more than others. I think my favourite was actually Private Dancer. It was a great song on Now 4. She was on Now 1 with Let's Stay Together, Now 3 with What's Love Got To Do With It, Now 6 We Don't Need Another Hero, the list goes on really. What else? There was Be Tender With Me Baby, that was a good one. I Don't Want To Lose You, that one in the 90s, it was really good. I Don't Want To Fight, even her version of Disco Inferno made Now 26, I think. So she's been here throughout the Now journey. She was here way before then, and her music will be here for years and decades to come. Absolute classic of music. R.I.P. Tina, simply the best indeed. Well, this has been a brilliant album, actually. I would say this has been one of the best Nows for ages and ages and ages. It's chock full of great stuff. There's only a very few bad ones on it. They really stand out, and that's the thing. The bad ones stand out. There's been about 3 incidences of short snippets of rap that otherwise ruined great tunes. I'm a great believer that you should do your own edits of these songs. You know, you can do it nowadays on Audacity or something. You can snip out bits of songs you don't like and then just make your own personal edit of them. And had I been the producer in these, I would have done that to about 3 or 4 of these songs. What have the classics said? Well, a great song by Calvin and Ellie, Miracle, kicks things off. Credit to Lewis, he's had a really big year this year. I really like the Lorene Tattoo one. I really, really like Kylie, another veteran of the scene. Badom, badom. Baby Don't Hurt Me is a bit laboured by David Guetta. 0800 Heaven, 0800 Heaven's pretty interesting. Nathan, Joel and Ella. Rudimental Return with an excellent Dancing Is Healing. We like Jazzy, we like Becky Hill. We had all those 80s star ones, best of which is probably One Republic and Runaway. We had Flo and Missy Elliott, it was okay. Olivia Dean was pretty interesting. Great comeback from Bolivia. Belinda Carlisle, big, big love. Really, really good song. Really good by Alessandra, Queen of Kings. And then as we moved on to disc two, good one from Miley, actually. Surprisingly good. Flowers. Pretty decent one from Ed. Pretty surprisingly good one from Post Malone. Meghan Trainor. Just a kind of brain fuck, really. I do not want to make of it. But I liked it. Apart from her attempt at me rapping for about two bars. Very impressed with Mae Muller, apart from the rap. Very impressed with Zara Larsson, no rap needed. Bit underwhelmed by Ellie Goulding by the end of the night. I think her chorus is a bit weak. Ollie Moores, I found her, was quite good. Sam Smith, Lose You, very good. Praising You, Rita and Fatboy, I like the video. I think she's a good actress. And I like seeing Norman Cook in there. I don't think it really improves on the original. Certainly You Make Me Feel Mighty Real significantly worse than the original. Adam Lambert and Sigala, Joel Corey, Katie Basin, his music's good, the vocals are shit. Best on the album, I think, Make Me, Brian Denham Audio. Nice return for Jess Glynn. Cat Burns, okay. Nothing But Thieves is very interesting. Welcome to the DCC. Brilliant song by Hozier, Eat Your Young. Shit song by the 75er. Well, not shit, which is very meh. Oh, Caroline, Let the Sun Come In, Noise Return for the Pretenders, and Simply the Best. What a way to end this brilliant volume. I've enjoyed it. I hope you have. Do let me know your thoughts. See you later, everyone. I know I sounded a bit coldy and bunged up in this one. I hope it doesn't make me sound too hard to listen to. But, you know, the show must go on. See you later.